Maybe some of all, like, welcome you to Asbury United Methodist Church. I had prepared a speech where I was going to talk about last time we gathered in Andy's church and about the bench.
Oh, sorry about that.
And everything like that. I want to tell you, Jim afterwards, when he got the floor, he went up to the guy to see if he would bend it back because he wanted to get some potato chips. He was very upset. Did you see that Geico commercial? And then I had another idea. I said, hey, Jim, I said, should we try to get Michael to bend it back? You've got your teeth in that. Nice. I do want to say, just as we gather here, what houses of worship are represented here besides Asbury United Methodist Church? What houses of worship? Yes, ma'am.
Tabernacle Baptist.
I went to a Baptist seminary. It's where I got my religion. Amen. Amen. How are the houses of worship? Presbyterian Church in Medford. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Har Zion Synagogue in Mount Holly.
Amen.
Vincent Town,
United Methodist Church. Amen.
Palmyra Moravian.
Palmyra Moravian Church in Cinnaminson.
Their church is 146 years old. I mean, they're not changing.
And Andy, that's tough. When you're preaching change and the choir singing, I shall not be moved. Anybody else? Wow. Yes, sir.
Church of the Good Shepherd, Morningwell.
Church of the Good Shepherd in Morningwell. Praise the Lord. Well, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. What I'd like to do to get us started, I'd like to say a word of prayer. I just want to introduce Jim Bruce. And this is a partnership today between the United Methodist Men and the Gift of Life. This is Donor Sabbath weekend. And as a pastor, you get somebody who's got a good idea, you want to just get out of their way and let them run with it. And that's what Jim has done. And Jim, he's done a great job. And we're very thankful for what God is doing and God has done through you. Is doing through you and has yet to do through you. And again, you really, the Lord used you to put this together. We want to recognize you this morning. Come on up and introduce Michael. God bless you.
I'm leaving.
Really?
This is a very special day in many different ways. And I'd like to prelude our speaker with just a couple of thoughts. One, as John said, this is part of Donor Sabbath, an annual recognition of the success of transplantation and the gifts that people give, usually upon death, although there's living donation also, to enable other people to live a full life. Right now there's 104,748 people as of this morning on an organ donor waiting list. You don't get on that list unless you die. They are praying for their miracle that somebody will die in just the right way. Less than 1% die in a way they can even be an organ donor. And right now across the country about half of those families do not agree to be organ donors. And so, I heard this story down in Washington, a donor recognition ceremony, and I usually end with it, but I want to start with it. And in that case, a father and his two daughters were next to his wife, who had been proclaimed brain dead, which means still on a ventilator, the body is being maintained by the machines, but there's no brain activity. She's dead. And they were being asked to consider organ donation for his wife, their mother. Tough time for any family to face that at that tragic moment. And he was saying no, and the two daughters were saying yes. And they continued that argument down in the cafeteria. And Orly came over to him and said, "Excuse me, sir, may I say something to you?" "What?" "Can only imagine." He says, "It's not a question of whether your wife's going to be an organ donor or not. She's going to be an organ donor. The question is whether you're going to donate to the ground or donate to save somebody's life." And he walked away. And the father sat there and thought about that, turned to the two daughters and said, "We need to go back upstairs. We have some papers to sign. And so I leave you in the front with that question. You're going to be an organ donor. Donate to the ground or to save one of those 104,000 people's lives. Today, a very special day, November 7th, is Pam's son Christopher's birthday. So she had a tough time today. I know she's not here. I would have her introduce the quilt. In memory of her son, she's been involved with the Life Donor Program as a speaker, sharing her service, her heart, in so many different ways. And that, when she first came there as a volunteer, I was president of the volunteer group at the time, that's how I met him. And one of the ideas we had was to, or she had, was to form an organization for donor families. They didn't have one at the time. They now have one. It's been in existence for about 10 years because of her work. The next thing she wanted to do with it was create a donor quilt. Each of those squares is some family who have donated their loved one's organs. And they put together a square, usually based on things that represent the life of their loved one. So each of these squares up here contains articles of clothing, something about their life.
Yeah.
And over, she said she wanted to do this. And the program said, no, we will never have a quilt here. I'll never tell Pam what she can't do. Because she ended up not only getting these squares, but she lived through each of those stories, which were in a book someplace, telling those stories. And her son's second row on the right-hand side is Christopher's, that she did. And she said she can't do these quilts anymore because it's so emotional, knowing the story of each of those donors. So if you would today, just keep in your prayers, her son, who at the age of 13, became an organ donor. His liver lives on, his two kidneys live on, in other people. And today he went to 25. She usually starts it by visiting the cemetery. I think she had a chance to do that today, I'm not sure. And so, I would have said that if she were here. You know, it's her son's birthday today. And she never forgets that. And so we will celebrate his birthday today. And what better way to do it than coming together as Christians to talk about what this is all about. And so with that, I'd like to introduce a friend. And people said, well, how did you get to know Michael? Well, one of my hobbies is to read transplant books and write reviews of them to help promote those books, and also it's a fascinating hobby to have. And one of the books I ran into was Michael Nolte's Burden But Unbroken. What I normally do after I get through writing a review, I reach out to the author and offer them the review to say, you know, is there any mistakes factually in this that I need to correct? And secondly, that I captured your message in my review. And often I end up being friends with that person, and when I find a patient who needs exactly what that book has, I can call them off and say, hey, would you mind autographing a book and mail it to this person? They're in the following situation. I have never had an author turn me down on that. And so that's how I got to meet Michael. But before I meet Michael, I introduce Michael, one of the last things, we have a ton of guests here that you won't recognize, not only from other churches, but from our Gift of Life Donor Network. And Steve Herman. Steve is a heart recipient of 17 months ago, and he was there last night. He was there last night at the synagogue over Mount Holly. We had another 8 people there, along with great turnout there at a wonderful event last night. And also Ruth Miller. Ruth, how long are you out from your heart transplant?
8 years.
I'm sorry?
8 years.
8 years. Steve lives down in Cherry Hill. Ruth's over in Willingboro, so right over by your church over there. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Michael. And Michael, come on up and share why you do this. Often, we talk about organ donation, but we also talk about organ and tissue donation. There's a sense almost like, you know, organ, wow, hearts, liver, tissue. You know what? If you couldn't see and you accepted the gift of a cornea, which is tissue, man, that's a pretty powerful gift. And so Michael is unique in talking about that aspect of it. Michael.
Thank you so much. Before I launch into the topic for which you gathered to hear me talk about, I just wanted to, first of all, say thank you to the ladies who prepared the delicious breakfast, and also to the guys for coming together for this cause and this purpose. I love when I get to be a guest in a Methodist church, because whenever it comes time to singing the hymns, we get to sing every single verse. And I love I love singing, and I love those congregational songs. Another thing, though, that I have a very close feeling in my heart about is the brotherhood of men in Christian faith. And years ago, I had the good fortune to be hog-swaggled and joined to a huge conference at a football stadium called Promise Keepers. I don't know if you've heard of that or not. And I'm Roman Catholic, and Promise Keepers and Roman Catholics for a while had sort of a wall between them for reasons I don't know, because we all worship the same God, and we're all going to go to the same place. But the Promise Keepers conference was a life-enhancing experience for me, too, 18 years ago. And what came out of that conference was the importance of having men as your brothers, and more importantly, to have them as your accountability partners. And I am an only son, and my two male cousins live at distant places, and so there are no Nolte brothers that I can hang with or anything like that. And I have two younger sisters that you'll hear about in my story today. But two guys that I was very close to, Phil and Steve, they asked us in the stadium, you know, to think about inviting somebody to serve as an accountability partner. And we made a pact right then that we would be accountability partners for each other. And we then gathered, we still did every Thursday evening. And we've had some kind of book study, we've done Man in the Mirror, we've done all kinds of things to make our marriages stronger, our fatherhood stronger. And we do hold each other to a certain level of, hey, that's not the kind of guy you said you wanted to be. You know, and of course, lots of times it's very social, and many times there's some beer involved with it too, and that becomes even more social. But we're just real normal guys that have wives that love us more than we deserve, and children that are blessed with health, and is a very important part of my life. And the day of the wreck in which you will hear me talk about, I was airlifted to a hospital 130 miles away from home, and two of the first people that were in the emergency room were Phil and Steve. And in my book, there's a picture of those two guys right here. And I don't go into this long thing in the story about accountability partners and what these guys mean to me, but that could be a whole other story because I had to keep the book somewhat focused. And but these guys were right there, and they did things for me throughout my stay. I was in the burn unit ICU for 2.5 months, and they would come down individually once a week so that I'd have company. And visiting hours stopped at 9 o'clock, and they would usually roll in about 8. So it was a 2.5-hour drive for them to get there after work. And the nurses would just close the drape, and we could have as much time together as what I needed at that point. And that's when I didn't have to be on, I didn't have to feel, I didn't have to entertain people or think, you know, oh, it was horrible. And Steve and Phil would just sit there with me until 1, 2 in the morning. And then they would drive back to Kansas City, which is our home. And it didn't dawn on me until many months later, when the narcotic fog was lifting from the painkillers, those guys went back to work with maybe 3 hours sleep the next day. And then 2 or 3 days later, here they would come again. One of them, Phil, was the guy that I asked to bring me home from the hospital when I wasn't even able to sit up straight. I had to be laid out on air mattresses in the back of the van. He literally, you'll see him in the video, he's the one that carried me into my front door. And then when it came time for the prosecution of the man that caused the wreck, I was required to be in the courtroom, and that's the first time I saw this man. And I knew that was going to be very emotionally draining, at the least, for me. And I asked Steve if he would drive me. I wasn't able to drive for about a year. And Steve drove my wife and I there, and he carried me emotionally through that experience. It was just made me go home when that was all done and just get in bed and pull the covers over my head as the news flashes were coming up. So the long story there is, you guys, just God bless you. God bless you for having this men's group. The men's group in my church is a very important part of my life. We meet on Wednesday mornings at 6:45, and we try to do things like this that are give backs to other people within our congregation. And we really are brothers on the road together. And so I'm so honored to be asked to be your guest for this occasion, for this group. And ladies, these guys couldn't do this without you. And I certainly know it. So thank you for that. That's just a little personal witness on my part, that where my belief system is very much in line with yours. And it's just special to be here today. So now, to tell you a bit about myself, is that I am from Kansas City. I am 54 years old. I am married 29 years. We have three daughters who are 23, 20, almost 21, and 16. And none of them are married yet, even though their father is a wedding planner by trade. And I own bridal salons in Kansas City. I'm also a designer. Now I'm an author twice, and I do a lot of speaking. And the speaking, it has been a very important part of my life. And my wife and daughters are very supportive of that. They know that it's probably the most important thing I can do with the second life I've been given. And though I love what I do for a career, it's what I do with my life that counts, and that's this. So I'm going to stick to a prepared text for two reasons. One, I don't want to ramble, and two, I want to get finished to the point that there's an additional DVD I'd love to share with you that's particularly great for guys. And then I'd love to take questions. And the questions, many times, are much better than anything I'm presenting. So part of the fact that I'll use new text, but it keeps us on track. Our lives are composed of days of sunshine and shadow, hilltops and valleys. Some days we stand on hilltops, and other, sometimes we can barely stand up because the valley is so deep and the shadow is so dark. I have a career in the business of weddings, i.e. sunshine and hilltop days for most families, you think. I've created happy celebrations for couples for 29 years now. From the outside, one might think that my life has been filled only with sunshine. I'm not rich nor famous, but I think I might be able to make a difference with my life. Not because of what I do for a living, but because of what has happened in my life. Of all the ways I could be spending this morning, nothing brings me more a sense of purpose than to be doing what I'm doing right now, and that is raising the importance and the awareness of organ donation. I have been there. I've actually been on both sides of this phenomenon called the gift of life. I thank you for inviting me to share my story. 6 years ago, I was on an interstate highway in Missouri. I had been pulled over for driving too long in a left-hand lane, and the state trooper came to my door and asked me to get out of my car and join me in his, thinking it would be safer than standing next to the highway with semis flying by us and none of them going to speed on it. Thus, I've been raised to respect the man with the big hat, and I got out of my car and got into his. It was a Ford Crown Victoria. A trucker was coming down the highway behind me and was driving with his right leg propped up on the dashboard. I was about to just get a warning, not even a ticket. When the driver bent down to retrieve his sunglasses, he pulled the steering wheel over to the right, his head below the dash. He never looked up, his foot never came off of the dash, it never touched the brake, and he slammed at full speed into the back of Ford Crown Victoria at 7 miles an hour. The trooper sitting next to me over the course of the next 3 minutes burned to death, and I suffered third and fourth degree burns over 40% of my body. I spent the next 10 weeks in a burn unit ICU at the University of Missouri, Columbia, Missouri, which is 130 miles, as I said, away from my home. The pain of being a burn victim that was that critically injured is absolutely off the chart and undescribable. The trauma of this wreck, though, was doubly difficult for my family, as only 11 months earlier, my niece, Micah, had been airlifted to that very same hospital. Micah was 18 years old. She had just graduated as valedictorian of her senior class and was enrolled to come to MU as a veterinarian student. On a clear Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock, on a cloud in the sky on June the 30th, she approached a rural railroad crossing that had no gates or lights or bells. My father is retired from Union Pacific Railroad after 42 years and has taught his 7 grandchildren the importance of when you're approaching tracks to stop, look, and listen. And Micah did all 3 of those things. As she went across the first set of tracks, a train came sweeping around a corner, 137 miles, going 62 miles, 137 cars going 62 miles an hour, and struck the Jeep in which she was driving. Micah was Union Pacific had forgotten to cut the trees on that corner, thus creating a blind curve. She was hurled out of her Jeep, flew through the air, and smashed on the rocks on the side of the tracks. She was killed instantly as the back of her skull was ripped off. I believe that much of our lives are determined by choices and consequences. As a teenager, Micah made very smart choices. She never smoked, she didn't drink, she did not do drugs. In my opinion, she had a very bright future ahead of her, and yet God called her It was the most difficult experience of my life. Her mother, you see, is my best friend, other than my wife. Her mother is just 2 years younger than I am. Sherry and I attended grade school, high school, and college together. We got engaged just 2 days apart to people that we both love. We were married 6 months apart. We were in each other's weddings. We started families at the same time, and we spent every holiday and spring break together. Micah, named for me, was like a fourth daughter to me. I share with you now the last photo that was taken of Micah and me eating homemade ice cream on my deck. This is a picture of Sarah. And then the next photo is the one I have taken later, 6 days later. I share this contrast of these pictures because, again, I just want to clarify, we have no promise of tomorrow. 6 days before this picture, Michael was sitting on my deck, reading homemade ice cream, preparing for the 4th of July. And this photograph was actually taken on the 4th of July, which is the night of the visitation. 1,200 people lined up outside the church in 104-degree temperature to come in and pay their last respects. The following day was a funeral. When she was taken to the hospital, the professionals there of the Gift of Life program came into the waiting room to discuss the donation of organs. My brother-in-law was taking care of their other three children, and Sherry asked me to help her make these very painful decisions. She was asked exactly what organs would she consider having retrieved and given to others that were awaiting transplants, and we knew nothing about this program or this system or this procedure, and each organ had to be identified and given consent. Heart? Yes. Liver? Yes. Pancreas? Sherry looked at me. We don't really know what a pancreas does, but we said yes. Kidneys? Yes, there's two of those. That would help two people. Lungs? Yes. Eyes? Mike, what do you think? And I said, just the corneas. Skin? Bone? Connective tissue? Mike, what do you think? And I said, no way, absolutely no way. I've never heard of this. I thought it sounded barbaric. I couldn't imagine what that procedure would be like if they would skin my beloved Micah. But I couldn't imagine that process, so I said, no, they cannot have my skin. For 30 hours, we sat next to Micah's bedside, holding her hand as she was on a ventilator, and the recipients were located all around the country. Finally, the matches were found, and Micah gave a gift of life, a chance for a second life, to 7 people. As I said in my eulogy a few days later, quote, as we are on our knees, sobbing in grief, 7 families around the country are dancing on their toes. We learned about the recipients. The 42-year-old father of 2 children was receiving 1 of her kidneys, and he had just 3 days to live if a transplant did not come. The 56-year-old grandmother, who lived in Pennsylvania, who received her pancreas, was able to bake cookies and jump rope with her grandchildren again, and her grandchildren colored his pictures of them doing that and sent them to the family. We received letters of appreciation from all of the recipients. For the next 11 months, until my own graft, I served as liaison between the recipient families and we, the donor family. I kept track of all the correspondence and the photos. I made a 3-ring binder for my sister and brother-in-law and tabbed it for each of the organs, liver, heart, kidneys, pancreas, on down the line. And as letters or photographs would come in of these people, I would put them in plastic sleeves in that binder, thinking that at some point down the road it would give my sister comfort. And indeed it did. They were comforted that Micah had made a difference, not just because she had lived, but with her lifestyle that gave her such a clean body to be able to donate all her solid organs. I learned a lot then about the Midwest Transplant Network and the deplorable lack of organs for patients praying for that transplant. I learned then of the 104,000, Jim told us this morning, people that in our nation right now just hanging on to only hope that today they will receive that call that a compatible organ has been found that will extend or save their life. If you think that you're completely in charge of your life, I urge you to re-examine your logic. We all have a limited number of grains of sand that trickle through the hourglass of life, and only one person knows that exact count. And he is not visible to us today, but you know he's in the sanctuary. If you want to make God smile, tell him what you're going to be doing a week from today. On May 22nd, 2003, I told my wife that I have a short trip to make to Central Missouri that would require me to leave at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I would be back in town by 3 p.m. I thought I was in charge of my day. 50 minutes later, I was being airlifted, unconscious, naked, and burned, to the same ICU where Micah had been taken. My parents thought that they were coming again to lose another family member. But this time, the story was different. Rather than becoming an organ donor, I became an organ recipient. Rather than being rushed off a helicopter with my life being shortened, my life was about to be extended. Officer Michael Newton, badge 799, had just filled the tank that morning with 19 gallons of gasoline 20 minutes earlier, and upon impact, the car exploded into an instant inferno. The car was completely engulfed in fire in 1.8 seconds, from the back bumper to the front fender. The flames were 40 feet high and seemed 2 miles away. In 3 seconds, the temperature inside the car raised 2,500 degrees. To give you a sense of how hot is 2,500 degrees, our broilers at home can broil a steak at 500 degrees. On 9/11, the World Trade Center steel beams, they started bending at 2,000 degrees. The temperature inside the car was 2,500 degrees in 3 seconds. We were in shock and we couldn't move. My legs set in flaming puddles of gasoline in my feet and melted off most of my feet. The investigation revealed that I had 15 seconds left in the car before I too would have died. Thanks to the courage of two strangers, Dave and Troy, I was pulled to the passenger window with just 15 seconds to spare. The fire burned off all of the skin on my face, my scalp, it melted off this left ear, and the back of my left hand was burned down to the bones. I was turned and handed the trooper my license at the time of the impact, and that's why the back of my left hand, particularly the left side of my head, received more burning than the rest of my body did. But to a much worse degree were my legs and my feet that were badly damaged. I lost all the skin, the muscles, the nerves, the ligaments. Both my Achilles tendons were burned in half. And like a blowtorch on the right-hand side, the fire burned through the bone, in my right leg. It was the deepest burns the hospital had ever treated, and the patient kept his legs. Initially, the doctors urged my wife to allow bilateral amputation, and she said she could not make that decision without me voting on it. She asked how long they could wait, and they said 2 weeks. I was in a coma. I woke up on the 13th day. I voted to try to keep my legs. I brought a short video of what that day and the resulting experience was like. It opens with a portrait of my family taken just 3 weeks before the wreck. I'd like to show the video now. You might want to shut the lights off too, it would be a little bit better.
I think we're okay.
He'd only been at the highway patrol for 2 years, but it was long enough to make a lasting impression.
Obviously, why so many people are worried about it, Martin.
Well, Mark, for 11 years, Michael Nolte's run his bridal shop here in Woodland Park, but he's been in the business nearly a quarter century, so in addition to wedding gowns, he'll also be doing wedding coordinator in July, which means for many, many families around here, It's almost like it was their own.
A wedding certainly brings out the best in you.
The magic of weddings, Michael Nolte recently said, is that a bride, as she puts on one of his dresses, is becoming Cinderella for the day.
I love being able to create that. I love having to be responsible for that emotion.
Ashley Dwight was one of Nolte's Cinderellas. He was her wedding coordinator too, amazing her every time she visited his shop and his attention to detail and his basic philosophy toward customers.
Regarding them as not just a potential sale, but they are going to be somebody that have a long-term relationship with.
That's what happened with Ashley and her family. And that's why she's sick with worry. Burns from the fire and crash cover much of Nolte's body, oppressed with death for a man who on her wedding day she called a lifesaver.
One of those guys that you go in to meet with and you think, okay, we're sitting out for our hour meeting, and you're there for 2.5 hours, and he knows all about you, and you know all about him.
Nolte has a number of weddings in the works this weekend. Staffner says true to his detailed approach to wedding planning, all those brides will get their chance at Cinderella.
Started his business in Columbia, Missouri, and that tonight is where he's hospitalized. Reported by the local Park Art Mosque, in Cinnaminson.
They can say his wife, a registered nurse, is by his side.
I'm sure that she's kicking the wrong hand of his body, but I don't know that she's, you know, thinking in her mind, what can this possibly mean for our family?
A family member would say walk out of the door in Rockwell's drawing, but they can't walk out of this nightmare.
Investigative team has been looking into the dangers of police version of the full crematory in the past year. Some believe the car is a serious fire hazard. Our instant investigation found at least 14 officers and maybe more have died in car fires after yearly accidents. A Florida Highway Patrol report in 1999 blamed the position of the gas tank and went under the fixes.
You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say.
I got to keep my legs and have my face and scalp and hand repaired so well. Well, someone ahead of me had made the generous decision to donate their skin, their tissue, and their bone. Skin is our largest organ, and the skin banks are in need of donations for patients like me. This valuable tissue is what sealed my body until my own skin could be harvested from my chest and my stomach, and then used for permanent grafting as they stapled it to my open wounds. In all, I had 17 surgeries, reconstructive and plastic surgeries, and I received 18 units of donated blood. It kept me alive and allowed me to heal. I stand before you this morning with this unique perspective of being both a donor uncle and a tissue and bone recipient. I have experiences on both sides of the OR table. Sharing my story is my way to give back, to thank God for this second life. He has allowed me to flip over my hourglass and start the sand trickle again. Donor families all over the country have flipped over many, many hourglasses because of the gift that they gave strangers. As I ask in the book subtitle, For What Was I Spared?, I reflect on what I call my toolbox theory. I believe that God has given us each a toolbox that is filled with tools that only we can use to their best advantage. For Michael Nolte, my tools were discovered when I grieved the loss of a beloved niece, and then I was nearly killed in a car explosion all within the same year. These experiences I am determined to turn into something positive. I think that maybe one of my tools might be stringing two sentences together, the art of being able to speak. That way I can share my story. I stand before you this morning with a full face of special makeup that they make for male burn victims and a fake ear to tell you that the spirit of my niece lives on in the lives of seven other families. And my family is still intact because of the donation of skin and bone that kept my body intact as well. I am embarrassed, deeply embarrassed, that it was the very donation that I discouraged my sister from making, that of skin and tissue and bone, that saved my life. God's message could not have been any more clear. He wants the quality of life for all of those that he leaves here on earth to be the best it can be, and we should do whatever we can to ensure that for others. Every time I'm asked to speak for audiences, I'm humbled each time by just reliving my story. In 3 weeks, I have the pleasure of turning another year older. I will be 55 on December the 9th. That would not be possible without the life-saving gift of skin and bone that I received. I am honored that I can stand up and I can tell you about an 18-year-old graduate and a 25-year-old trooper who had used the tools in their toolbox to touch all the lives that God needed them to touch in their short time, and then he called them home. Alfred Lord Tennyson said, "'Tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all." When I lost Micah, I argued that point for a long time. If I hadn't loved her so much, I would not have hurt so much in missing her. But now I know what Tennyson meant, and I am so glad that I had her to love for the years that I did. As I lurch through this second life, I feel like I am called to make each day count and to turn the bad, no, the horrible, into something good. I've offered the book, Burned and Not Broken, For What Was I Spared?, and it sold 7,000 copies thus far. When I receive an email from someone, another burn victim, or one of our soldiers in Iraq who's been burned, who's gotten the book, or I hear from their families, and they say that it has helped them, I know that I've made a difference. I speak throughout the United States and Canada now, anytime the invitation comes, and I hope that in those speaking presentations, I've made a difference. I helped my U.S. Senator, Jim Talent, push a bill through Congress that used our wreck as a springboard as to why motorists should move to the left now when they see flashing lights on the shoulder. President Bush signed that bill into national law 2 years after the wreck. It's called the Pass with Care Law. I know then that I made a difference. The book is now being drafted as a screenplay and will become a Hallmark Hall of Fame movie, hopefully saving lives on the highway and inspiring others to be the good Samaritans that Dave and Troy were for me. I think that that will make a difference. The profits from the book sales and the stipends I received as a speaker, as I earned as a speaker, they go into the Nolte Rescue Scholarship Fund that I've established for the son of the trooper and the daughters of my lifesavers. We'll have pictures of them now. This is a photograph of the trooper's widow and their little boy, Tyler. This was 2 years after the wreck that I was allowed to meet everyone at that point because we had so much trauma going on. This is Shawnee, Tyler, and this is Tyler. And so the grant that we were able to get through Jim's hard work, that money will go into putting this little guy through college, as well as two of the next little gals we're going to see. This is Brooke and Lacey. They are two of the daughters of one of the men that saved my life, and the other gentleman has two daughters, and I apologize, I didn't bring the pictures with me. So I've got four little girls who are going to have gorgeous weddings in college, And then Tyler knew who will have college as well. And if he gets married, like to have a wedding I can help with, I'll be glad to give back those tools as well, too. So anyway, that's where the money goes from the sales of the book and the speaking gigs. I know that that will make a difference. I hope that none of you have to suffer through what I have lived through. And I hope that you will have this conversation with your family, because we all are going to eventually leave this earth. I urge you to talk to your family and tell them your wishes, talking about organ donation. Today, 18 people are going to die in the United States because the call didn't come. There was no compatible organ found. Let's shrink that number from 18 to as close to zero as possible within our lifetime. Even in our inevitable passings, we can make a difference. And when that day comes and God does call us home, this is important to remember, that when we get to the gate, God is not going to ask us, how many friends did you have? But rather, he's going to say, to how many were you a friend? So this morning, I thank you from the bottom of my heart and the soles of my feet for being my friend and listening to my story. God bless you all and all your families with good health.
City, Missouri. Two things I'd just like to add before we go to question and answers. One, when Ruth and Steve and I get together in our transplant groups, one thing we always do is introduce ourselves and what our gifts were, and donor families are usually part of the networks. And sometimes when a family is not able to donate to the loved one's organs because something's wrong with them or because of how they die, they say, and you know, I was only a tissue donor. And we try to tell them, take the word only out of that. I think today you can appreciate it. There's no only in front of tissue donation. It saves lives. It gives sight to grandparents who have never seen the grandchildren. It gives sight to a spouse who hasn't seen their spouse in 30 years. Pam didn't realize that she was a recipient until she had some jaw reconstruction work done and found out later that that was donated bone. And so she said, wow, I'm a recipient as well as a donor. So if you ever meet people who have been only a tissue donor, say no, take the word only out of that. The other question was asked before, how can we get Michael's book? It's out of publication right now, but both on Amazon and Barnes & Noble, they have copies there. So if you can order it online if you'd like a copy. And with that, I'd like to open up to questions and answers about not only his story, but anything about organ tissue donation as part of our National Donor Sabbath event. So, what questions does anybody have? Yes, Betty.
Do you have any more surgeries to look forward to? Loosely say that.
Well, I thought that I was going to be perhaps finished with them, and just actually, it was last November. Though the right leg is the one in which the fire burned through the bone, and this is the one that barks the loudest most of the time. The left leg, the vascular system, had been so impaired by the burning that many of the veins collapsed, and so I was taken back in the hospital last November to have these, many of these veins, the burn ones that had flattened like drinking straws, taken out and then transplanted new veins in. And then, so this is working. Stings a little, but doesn't bark as much as this one. And then 4 months ago, I was at a routine office exam for a new glasses prescription, and my optometrist, who's known me for years, said, Michael, you've got a little blood clot in your left eye, and I need you to come back in 2 weeks. I'm back in 2 weeks, and he goes, we're going the wrong direction. He had given me some drops, and he said, that didn't go away, and you have more. I need you to get into a retina specialist right away. And the next day, I was in the hospital with a retina specialist, and I had developed 15 blood clots in my left eye. This was the eye that was hit with the fireball, this side. And I was diagnosed with a condition called impending retinal vein occlusion, which is the precursor of a stroke, a massive stroke that's about to happen. And so that was something that was caught just in the nick of time by, I don't even call it a fluke anymore, I just call these things that have happened to me a God incidence. That a routine eye exam revealed that I had impending retinal vein occlusion and I was about to have a massive stroke. Because the full skull was filled with infection because of the, again, the vascular system being impaired on this left side of my face. And because of the pain levels that I experienced in the burn unit and in the debridement tank where they rip off your burn tissue down to where they have flushed fresh tissue, which is, they know whether it's fresh tissue when you begin to bleed. That pain is, you know, they scale it from 1 to 10. It's, I mean, beyond 100. But I had desensitized myself to pain to the point that my threshold of pain had risen so high that I did not feel this massive skull infection that I had. So it was, again, a wonderful God incidence that now that's cleared up. So I was on massive doses of antibiotic for 30 days, and the infection is cleared up, and the blood is draining out of my left eye now, and I'm seeing just fine. So, yeah, praise God, exactly. And
yes, sir. Well, God bless you for what you've gone through. I wish I looked after it if you didn't want to go spend it.
It's all right.
Anyway, when you were showing the film up there, I noticed that when I got to the part where you were in the hospital and so forth, that your head went down. You didn't look at it. Is that still painful for you to look at? Is that something that
it,
just
it, I mean, it takes just that much of a trigger for me to, and if I have yet 10 more minutes I want to share with you, I just can't go back to that place yet. And so during that time, when the photographs are of me and that whole hospital experience, which was so nightmarish, that's the time that I can always pray for Officer Newton and his family, and just remembering him. I remember him all the time when I go by the interstate. The mile marker there is a huge white cross about 8 feet high that has his badge and his name on it. There's flags and flowers there. I always lay a wreath at the anniversary of the crash, May 22nd, and at Christmas time, and on his birthday in April. His wife and little boy, they live about 4 hours away, and so they don't know how to do this, but the state patrol that's in that area knows, and I don't know if they know I do it or not. I don't put cards on them, but I always wanted to be something that is not forgotten. I want motorists to think, wow, something catastrophic must have happened at this spot because of that white cross. And if people would remember that lives can be taken and snuffed out on a highway like that, I'm glad to do my part to paint the cross, to bring a wreath, to remember it. At the beginning, I could even pass that cross as we would go back and forth up that highway. I had to go back to the hospital every week for clinic visits. My anxiety attacks would be, I would just drench sweat the first time I stopped at the cross on the service road. I thought I can get out of this car and I can go over to the cross. I got to the cross and I stood by it, I couldn't touch it, and I just threw up all over the grass. And so I have acclimated myself through good counseling for post-traumatic stress syndrome and survivor's guilt, which I suffered a lot of and I didn't even know what that was, to get past that a little bit, that I can function. But the photographs of me in the hospital are still a trigger, and it gives me a chance, though, to stop thinking about me, thinking about my Newton's family, thinking about my lifesavers and their family, thinking about the man who caused the wreck and his family. So it gives me a couple minutes of prayer time. Yes, sir?
Mike, tell everyone about what you did for the guy that was your lifesaver.
There were two, Dave and Troy, and in a minute, I wanted to cut short the questions, but there's kind of a neat little other DVD I'd love to show you that CBS did. But the two men that saved my life, Dave Ryan and Troy Greencutter, were not riding together in the car at the same time. Neither of them have any experience with this type of thing. 75 people stopped to watch, and these were the two men who were brave enough to reach inside a burning car, belching black smoke, and they couldn't even see that there was a passenger in the car. And the window was broken out, and they felt my shoulder kind of slump down toward the dashboard like this. And they reached in one under one armpit, and then Troy came running up and got the other armpit, and they pulled me out of that window in one fell swoop. And you know, you think about that. I mean, I'm 6'2" tall, 189 pounds. This car is on fire. It's 2,500 degrees. It's a huge Mission Impossible, literally. And they pulled me out of that car and did not receive any burns themselves. Well, every time there's any opportunity that I can ever say thank you to them, if it's to register for a free pizza, I put their name in the box. If it's a quilt at a church social auction, I put their name in the raffle box. Well, when the time came and I saw that Our nation had opened up the Medal of Freedom Award to be given to civilians 2 years ago, and that three people would be the recipients of the Medal of Honor, excuse me, not Medal of Freedom, the Medal of Honor. I filled out the application forms and I wrote the essay, and writing maybe is one of my tools, and I wrote an essay as to why I felt Dave and Troy would be recipients of the Medal of Honor. And then they do background checks of each of these folks, and Dave passed that, and I knew nothing about this happening. I mean, once I submitted the application, I literally forgot about it, and because I'm always thinking of those guys. And I got a call a few months ago from Dave, and he goes, Michael, this is, I got a call from Washington, D.C. that said that I'm going to be receiving the Medal of Honor. Do you know anything about that? And I said, keep talking. He goes, well, it says actually that you're the one who nominated me for this, and then read me part of the essay that you wrote about why I would be a recipient. I said, oh yeah, I forgot. I said, Dave, to me it was no more than a free pizza. I just didn't think about it. And so anyway, out of the thousands of people who were nominated, each state had one winner who's on the website, log in medaloffreedom.com, and of those 50, three were then to receive the actual medal, to be recipients. And so one of my good Samaritans did receive just a few months ago from President Obama the Medal of Freedom for his heroism in rescuing me and saving my life. And there are only, there's less than 100 living Medal of Freedom recipients right now. And actually, kind of a little point of interest, and some of you that maybe veterans know this, that our Medal of Honor, I keep boring those words, I apologize, our Medal of Honor recipients are regarded as national treasures. And they will always be invited to sit on the inaugural platform on the Capitol steps at the inauguration of all future presidents. Anytime Dave is in Washington, D.C., he will have a Secret Serviceman with him as a guard. When he and his wife, Susan, and their daughter, Michelle, flew to Washington, D.C., there were two limos that picked them up, one that guarded Dave and one that guarded his wife and daughter. And then there was a number of receptions and dinners and black tie events for them. As soon as the news broke, we knew 2 days in advance, and we weren't allowed to tell anyone, of course, but there was wonderful media coverage about it. My daughter immediately said, my one who's still at home, Dad, are you going to go to Washington, D.C. to be there with the Bryans? And I said, you know, I thought about it, and yes, I would love to go and share that moment with Dave, but if I had gone, it would have taken the focus away from him. It would have been all about me. I was the burn victim. I was the guy who was saved. And the reporters would want the story, well, how do you feel about this man who saved your life? And I did not want that. I had been in the media plenty of times, as you saw. It was front page news for 3 days all through Missouri. And the news media was very kind in their coverage of the trooper's family and their loss and my recovery. And so I had cameras around me all the time. The last thing they needed was more Michael Nolte quotes. But yeah, but Dave is a Medal of Honor recipient. Yes, sir.
Does the age of the donor affect the effectiveness of the wording?
The likelihood? To an extent, and yet those rules change all the time. To be a tissue donor now, it's just under 70 is what they're looking for there, to be a skin and bone donor. However, we never want to tell people that are beyond 70, don't consider being an organ donor, because now, with technology and advances that they've made in medicine, which are just light years ahead of time, Jen and I both know of two instances where a 90-year-old patient passed away and wanted to be an organ donor, and their livers, which regenerate themselves, were still transplantable. And so at 90, so if you are inclined to be an organ donor and you tell your family that's my wishes, regardless of what I think my health is and regardless of what my chronological age is, let the doctors at the time of your demise make that assessment as to what can be done for you. Yes, ma'am.
I have one more question.
Please, as many
you
as
talk about the makeup.
Yes.
That you put on your face. Mm-hmm. What is that?
It's a part of in my occupational therapy, which I had a wonderful lady named Kathy who helped me and other male burn victims, when we got to the point that our scarring was down and I had to wear this flat mask that pressed my skin back into shape, because you saw in the video I looked nothing like this. And one of the things I have to tell you, that in burn recovery, the most important thing is compression. Because when skin grows back, it grows back wild like a grapevine. And when you see burn patients that have horrible, gnarly, and big scarring, they call it keloids. that patient has probably not been what we call physician compliant, and I had to wear a pressurized mask that was like shrink wrapping my face in saran wrap to make this face come back to this level. And my hand had a garment called a Jobst, J-O-B-S-T, glove that was actually about half the size of my hand, and you squeeze it in, and it's a, I won't even say it's spandex and lycra, it's a special product, but we'll call it that, that you get your hand into. And so my fingers were not webbed. My fingers actually looked like a marshmallow that had been put in a campfire and just, you know, a marshmallow puffs up and it's all black with a husk on it. That's how all of my fingers looked. And then when they cut all that away and regrafted the skin here from the donor skin, I had to wear this very tight glove for a year. But I have my fingers now, and I have fingernails again, and I now have full range of motion back in this hand, which we did not think was going to happen. On my legs, I had to wear the equivalent of ski tights for 23 hours a day for 2 years. Very painful, at the, particularly at the beginning, as all those nerves come back to life. And the very first set of compression tights that I had on, they hurt so bad by the time I got back from the burn clinic that I asked my wife for a pair of scissors and I cut them off, and they're $600 a pair. I mean, I was like crying and screaming, they were in so much pain. Even today though, I have compression tights on now because it helps, now that I've had the vascular surgery, it helps with the circulation. But these now stop right about here and they stay on. So the benefit of my face being remolded back into how I look happened for two reasons. Number one, I was very physician compliant. I kept the compression garment on my face and my hand. And the doctor had this photograph, which this had been taken in that family photo that we opened the video with. This was taken at that same time, just 3 weeks before the wreck. I had never seen the proofs. The photographer who did this family photo and said, I've got to get a good picture for you for business purposes to have. And he just snapped this shot. He printed off that 8x10 and raced it through the back roads because the interstate was shut down, and got to the hospital with that 8x10 and my family. And so the doctors had a very recent picture as to who that burn victim was and how he was supposed to look when they got done operating on him. And they used that picture as their map to put my face back together. So when my scarring flattened and the swelling went down, then I learned about makeup application. And there's a special makeup they make for men that comes in, well, I guess ladies too, but I mean, guys are just so, you know, whacked out about wearing makeup. And we actually don't even call it makeup, it's called cover. That's how we do it. It comes in 17 different skin tones. And I learned, of course, you know, all of us guys are there at our table with our lesson, and we're painting a house. You know, we get all brush marks in here and all that. And the guy goes, no, it's stipple. So I learned about stippling, and so I put this on, and it's very opaque and very thick. And if I did not have it on, parts of my face would give up the color of this shirt, because where the grafted skin goes on, it comes on in pieces about the size of a domino. And of course, it comes from a variety of donors, and so none of it matches. So I have this patchwork of skin on my face, and so by putting the cover up on, it evens it out. And then they have a little bronzing powder that I can give myself a little bit of tan and color with. So that's what I do. And when I take this shirt off, if I open this collar right now, you can see this big old ring of makeup in here. And after I was able to drive after about a year and a half, and I would take, and I started to wear the cover up, and I take shirts to the cleaners. You know, there was this kid working behind the counter, and he's looking at my collars, and he goes, oh, looks like your wife's been wearing your shirts. Oh, shut up and take my money. So I'm always, you know, aware of that, but it's definitely in there. I have ring around the collar every day.
Why don't you continue to hear,
because
somebody's going to ask me about that left ear.
Well, I do mention about my ear. I mean, again, keep in mind, you all are the trooper, and I'm in the car, and I turn to my left to hand him my driver's license when he's giving me this warning for driving too long in a light. And his last words to me, as he knew that I was on my way to plan the funeral of a friend, were, I'm sorry for your loss, which really resonated with me that a trooper would say something like that he would even care. And that's when the car exploded, the fireball comes through from the trunk, and It isn't a case of like in the movies you see a ball of fire, though I know there are fireballs and I know that that happens. I mean, it happened so instantaneously. But this side just seared off, and so we had no bones in our ear, and this just melted off like jello. And I had just a hole in my skull. And one of those photographs, it's been flipped over so that if you looked closely, you could see I have no ear on the other side of my skull. But there was just a hole here, and blood was just draining out of it in the ER. And my wife just knew when she finally got to the hospital 4 hours later, because the interstate was closed down, and she had to have a police escort to get her down the highway, and they were cutting through. It was just horrible. And Barbie's a nurse for 20 years, and then had to take a leave of absence, of course, at the time of the wreck, run our businesses and our daughters and me. So she knew that I had a massive head injury because this blood was dripping out of my ear. But the MRI revealed that I did not have, which is amazing since neither of us had seatbelts on, neither of us were thrown from the car, neither of us suffered any broken bones at all, and thus the title of the book, Burned But Not Broken. Part of it is we had no broken bones. We were burned as a result of a faulty gas line tank. To get to the point now about the ear is that one of the things that burn doctors are not too concerned about initially is cosmetics, about how you're going to look. They want to stabilize your life. They want to stabilize your electrolytes, your circulatory system, and they need to seal your body. And so this ear was not a high priority for them. But how they did that was they created a mold of this ear and then took that mold off and put it on this side. And they filled that mold with jello, so to speak, that was actually cartilage and cellulite from the back end of my backside right here, and filled it with that, and that held and molded and stiffened for several days, that then became a few weeks, and then when that ear was formed, like a plaster Paris mold, they chiseled that off, and then the doctor spent a whole afternoon sitting on a stool next to my bed. And I, of course, I have IVs in both arms that are running morphine at full throttle. And he starts cutting into this ear tissue to create these curves and these ears to fine-tune that. So I don't know if you know this or not, but we do not typically have our right ear and our left ear are not the same. And they do some kind of a testing now that you, and some of them suspect to be a therapist. I don't know exactly how they do this, but they can determine this by an ear formation at a right side or left side. Well, I could throw them off because I have matching ears. So if I really wanted to do something really naughty, I could get by with it. They wouldn't know it from my ear. So I can say to you with lightness that we all know that people, we've known people in our life that live with their head up their butt. Well, today you're looking at somebody who lives with his butt on his head.
Ellen, you had a question?
Yes.
That was the first time because you saw my feet in one of the operating room shots with all that tissue burned off, and then that's before they started the cutting off, because all of that flesh was dead. So I have prosthetics in the bottom of my shoes that make up for the unevenness of my feet now so that I can stand balanced. But oh my gosh, the pain in my feet and legs and ankle was just unbelievable, and they needed to weigh me. Why that was so important, I don't know. And I had to stand on a scale. And so they put a walker next to my bed. And I mean, this was a sweat-inducing, anxiety-ridden moment. And I scooted off to the edge of the bed, and they raised the bed to where all I needed to do, the scale was in front of me. It was one of those digital scales, you know, that went beep-beep. And I had to simply stand up, but I had to put both feet on that scale at one time, briefly, to register my weight. Honestly, I went into a huge anxiety meltdown about it because I knew how bad that was going to hurt. Because when they would take me out of my wheelchair and put me in the debridement tank, I had to pivot briefly on my left foot. I would be screaming. And so when I stood on the scale for the first time, I finally got up there and said, come on, you can do it, you can stand. We just need you to stand for just 3 seconds, just so this will register. We just need you to stand. oh, I can't do it, I can't do it, you know, I'm praying almost. And I finally stood up, and this was, oh, at least 8 weeks into it, that I had never stood. And I stood just long enough for that digital readout to bing, 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 with my seat, and then I just fell back onto the bed, dripping in sweat. It hurt so bad. I mean, they had to bathe me from just standing that first time. I had to bathe me, change my sheets, change my gown. Ugh. And the pain was incredible. But I'm so bullheaded, ask Barney, that I was not. I thought, I walked out of this house, I'm walking back into this house. I am not going to be rolled in on a stretcher. I'm not going to be rolled in a wheelchair. I'm going to walk back into my home. And a part of my bullheadedness, guys, listen to this and learn from this. Sometimes there's people a lot smarter than us. Many times it could be the women in our lives. I lobbied to come home probably 3 weeks too early. I thought things would be better once I got home. And it was so much rougher for my wife to deal with me and my dressing changes and getting me up out of bed and getting semi-dressed, and the bathroom was a joke and there was no showers to be had. And if I had stayed in the ICU, there was a whole team of nurses 24 hours a day that were semi-inclined to take care of me. I mean, I tried to always be appreciative, but I had to walk. I had to do that. It hurt horribly. By the time I got to the top of the steps there and people were helping me up and I'm holding on that fence post, I was so hoarse from having had the ventilator down my throat so many times for OR and stuff like that, that my voice was very raspy and I was so weak I could barely croak out the words, I am home. But standing was extremely painful.
How much hearing loss have you lost in your last year?
At the beginning, I had the hearing loss. I was initially deaf completely for 8 months in this year. And they don't know what exactly caused it. It wasn't the fact that the earlobe got knocked off, but one of two things happened. Either it was the sound of the explosion when the car blew up that deafened me, or in the helicopter, one of the painkillers that they gave me was so potent that the side effect of a painkiller is deafness. But that's, you know, I guess if it's, you know, you're jumping off the spine board because your pain is so bad, or to be deaf, they made that decision. So for 8 months I was deaf, and then it came back gradually, and now I can hear almost as well out of this one as I can this one. Yes, sir?
Do you take anti-rejection medicine?
No, the question is, do I take anti-rejection medicine? I don't take it. While I was in the hospital, there was never a done day when it was like, okay, all of the skin and all of the bone has been received and hosted by the body, and he's done, he's out of the woods. Because the skin comes out of the skin bank in little domino-sized slices, in little plastic sheets like an American cheese slice, it's kind of like that, and they lay those on, part of it floats on top of our dermis, and then part of it they staple into the bone, if it's a ligament or a tendon or a muscle. And then the body will eventually, the skin will eventually fail. We cannot host donor skin forever. And what a good burn doctor will do is he will know when we've tricked the body into thinking, okay, this is foreign skin, but we're going to host it and it can stay here for our party. And just as that's beginning to actually rot, which has this horrible stench to it, as those different pieces of skin would start to decay, back into OR I go, then rip those off, and then put more on. And so sometimes it would be donor skin, sometimes it would be my skin, but from here on down, I am a donor of my own skin. That's called an autograft, and meaning that we will always host our own skin. Sometimes burn victims are burned so badly that the only place they can get skin from that burn victim is from their scalp. And I've seen many people in their 60s or 70s that were burned in a cooking fire or something like that, and their hands or whatever, and maybe their other skin parts aren't good, but their scalp skin is always very young. And how they retrieve that skin is very interesting. I'll share that with you because it was because of my misunderstanding and my misconception as to how was skin harvested that I said no for mica. Because I thought it would be gory and bloody and awful, and maybe we wouldn't be able to have an open casket for it, and I just, ugh. It's nothing like that. What they do is that they take a little instrument that is, it's electric, of course, and it's going to sound bad, and it isn't like it sounds. And of course, obviously, the donor has already is deceased. And if they take it off of the patient themselves, I'm put under in general anesthesia, but they just plane off like a little cheese slicer the very top layer of skin, and it is paper thin that they take off. And what the body would look like when it's finished, if you should opt to be a skin donor, is that you just have a bright sunburn. There's no blood oozing out. They also, it does not interfere with an open casket because they stop the harvesting here and here, and all the primary areas are left untouched. So if you would ever be a skin donor, consider that. They just plane off that top layer of skin in little sheets. And then it all becomes sanitized, purified, checked for any diseases or anything like that before it's then put into skin bags. I will never be able to thank my donors, plural, because there were so many of them and I had skin from all over the country brought in. So I don't know whose bone and whose skin, there was a lot of people.
Yes, we've talked a lot about the giving of life and this donation upon death.
Right.
And obviously the importance of us talking with our family members and knowing our wishes. Talk a little bit about, I guess, living donation. Maybe, I feel like I know a little, but maybe what organs can be donated and still live. Mm-hmm. And also, if some of us here felt like, well, that's something I'd like to possibly do, would you say, you know, get in touch with, you know, an organization, looking at, or do you say, okay, wait until someone you know and a family member at some point may need, because it's a closer match genetically.
How about in every state, there is what's called an OPO, that stands for Organ Procurement Organization, and those are the people who help organize transplants. And the two organs that you can be a living donor for would be kidneys, because we can easily function with just one kidney, and also a part of our liver. Because the liver will, you can take off the bottom part of the liver and it will grow back to full size in 6 weeks.
With the liver, could you actually donate part of it multiple times throughout your life, or no?
Just once. The part that grows back is not quite the same, so you can only do that once. The other organ you can donate, it's all done when it's done, is one of your two lungs. Oh. Again, it's kind of extreme. You probably wouldn't want to consider that unless you had, you know, your spouse dying, and you could save a life with that.
Yep.
Actually, the Organ Procurement Organization, they're just starting to get involved in the living donor side. They're involved in the recovery of deceased organs. And so it's the hospitals that are traditionally where you would go and be what we call an altruistic donor, or if you had somebody you knew. Like a couple of years ago, the United Methodist minister donated her kidney to a rabbi in the community, altruistically, and so they could go to the hospital where he was being treated and she would offer that. Now that's changing. The Organ Procurement Organization are just now getting involved in that, and you may have seen in the paper about these chains of organs being donated. So you have, let's say, John Dahl needs a kidney, I'm willing to donate to him, but I'm not a match. Well, we can't do it. Well, maybe somebody else is a match, and they're willing to donate to their loved one who's not a match, right? And so we end up registering, and most recently I saw 14 people in that chain involved with donating kidneys, receiving kidneys, cross matches, so everybody ended up getting a kidney. And then of course they come off the deceased donor list because they got, or are waiting for a deceased donor because of that. So it's being done more and more, and it's being done in better technology. The success rate on both sides is really excellent these days. And so it's very possible, and there are people who are saying, you know what, I've got an extra kidney, I just want to donate it. They'll go to a hospital and say, yeah, they're going to be evaluated very carefully. Are you crazy? You know, why are you doing this? So they'll be carefully psychologically evaluated. But if they're truly past that, they will then enter a pool, and there will be found somebody who's waiting, who, when they know or not, doesn't make a difference, they can give it to them. So a very viable option these days, more and more. In fact, it was only a couple of years ago, the number of kidney donors that were living versus deceased donors finally exceeded the deceased donors.
Yes, sir?
Does weather changes affect you? Do you feel any
No, it isn't like
or any
any itching or any problems with weather changing, like rainy weather, etc.?
Question is, does weather affect pain levels, basically, or do I have any reaction to it? Not like rheumatism or arthritis in that respect. Barometric pressure doesn't necessarily do it, except when I'm flying in pressurized cabins. I always am asking for the extra row or the bulkhead where I've got some extra leg room. It's very important I can keep swinging these legs a bit, because there they'll really sting. In the early times, I mean, I had to be one of those people that was mad at the airport with a wheelchair, and they would wheel me through, or I'd get on the little bus and the go-kart thing, and you know, what I've learned about that, you know, but that doesn't affect me in that respect, except flying a little bit long distances. What does affect me though is ultraviolet light, and just this year I got it all clear from my burn doctor that I could begin having a little bit of sun exposure on my face. Prior to this, I would always have to wear an SPF and sunscreen of 90, which is, you might as well just smear some liquid concrete on at 90, because I could walk to the end of my driveway to pick up my newspaper and come back, and if I didn't have my umbrella with me, I would come back with my forehead just scorched. Because the skin on my face was so thin and so delicate that it would just scorch like that. And my forehead would get so tight from that scorching, I couldn't even squint for about 10 days. And so, but now I can be in the sun with some sunscreen, of course. Yes, ma'am?
Do you have to shave?
I do. My beard came back, unfortunately. I need that more than me. Yes, I do. And this is my real hair that came back, so I was lucky there. That's my real hair as well. Yes, sir?
What's the actual medication you take now for every day that you get?
Now I'm not taking any anti-rejection type drugs. That, coming back to that question, meaning that, and I didn't exactly answer that question, I need to bounce back to that. One of the things, it wasn't so much about rejection, it was the body was just to host it, but it was the element zinc is very beneficial to the formulation of fresh skin. So I took zinc all the time, and water. I mean, I was just logged with water to help new skin grow. But there wasn't really, they just had to keep me from getting infected. Most of the burn victims that die will not specifically die of the burns, they will die of an infection. And so in the burn unit, I was extremely isolated. It was only burn patients that were there, and even my closest family had to be gowned, hatted, masked, and gloved to just be in the room with me. And there was air flowing over me all the time and things like that, so no infection. Now, the only meds that I am on is I have restorative sleep is very important too. You have to have restorative sleep to generate fresh skin cells. And so I have a sleep medication that helps get me to REM sleep. And now, of course, some painkiller. But my painkiller is not narcotic. I mean, I can take ibuprofen, four of them. I can take them in the morning. About 5 o'clock, I'm going to need them. And then I do have my friend Morph that I keep one in my pocket, but I only need Morph about, maybe once every 3 weeks, and it's only 15 milligrams. If I am, because I'm walking and working, and in my stores a lot, and I'm back directing weddings, so if I'm on my legs a lot and walking on hard surfaces, by the end of the day, I know they're gonna be barking. And that may be, by 9 o'clock, if that pain is not relieved when I go home and I've set up in the recliner and I have this little vibrating thing that they set on to kind of distract them. If it's still there, and I'm thinking, okay, unless I take that morphine, I am not gonna get restorative sleep, but I have to get restorative sleep in order for the skin to continue to grow. So I will finally take a morphine. But fortunately, I never became addicted to it. And one of the things that helped me understand it was okay to take the pain medication, I'll share this, though it's kind of a sidebar. My burn doctor told me that narcotic painkillers, and I was on all of them that you can imagine, and if you know anything about prescriptions, it is Versed, Ativan, fentanyl. Morphine was almost like sucking on a lollipop. That's how ineffective morphine was at the beginning. They held all, I mean, major drugs to keep that pain at bay, and it never did. But when I was so worried that, oh my gosh, I'm going to end up, you know, in drug rehab out of this, and he said, if you have what's called authentic pain, the pain killed the narcotic will go to the authentic pain and douse that out, and you won't use any more than you need. But it's when you don't have authentic pain and you're taking morphine, for instance, which is an opiate-based drug, that then is when you get that rush and you get that high, or you start getting fuzzy in the head. And I have developed a completely new appreciation for people that have gone, for instance, to the Betty Ford Clinic to get off of prescription painkiller. You know, I used to think about people like Elizabeth Taylor, for instance, you know, a celebrity, you know, multimillionaire, and how many times has she been to the Betty Ford Clinic? And I thought, oh, that's just because she's weak, and that's just because she's got this indulged life, and that's because she just doesn't want to try and doesn't want to work. I feel so badly about how I threw that label out and I judged that person, because I, number one, had not walked in her shoes. The fact that she is a celebrity in the country, that's her job. That's the tools in her toolbox that God gave her. It's not my place to judge her addiction to prescription painkiller. And what I realized is that everyone that ever got addicted to prescription painkiller was initially given that painkiller because they had authentic pain. And maybe they were not blessed with a support group around them like I have with my wife and my daughters that would put up with my crabbiness until maybe ibuprofen would kick in. Or they would say, Dad, lay down, get your legs up, come on, can we bring you some ice water? You know, let's watch some mind, I'll watch a Seinfeld rerun or something like that to get my mind up. And that's until the less potent painkiller would kick in. Believe me, the quicker fix.